My name is Edward Dennis. I'm an artist here in Arizona, Phoenix.
My secret potion will penetrate every cell in your body, keeping you eternally beautiful. Death cannot destroy you. I have preserved your beauty for the ages.
I thought you said she was dead.
Welcome to Cold Hands Host with Monica Torres.
And tell us a little bit about your background as far as history and art and how you got into it, and specifically what you do.
History and art. I do digital art mainly these days, just because it has a faster turnaround rate, make more money doing it. And my history in art, I guess I've always been an artist, so I've always drawn. I've always been making things from this morning to this afternoon since I was five. That's what I've always been doing.
Yeah, and so I'd like at least my listeners and viewers to know a little bit about like why I invited you here on the red sofa and how we know each other. And thanks to technology today, we actually met through social media.
On Instagram.
And I am a huge follower of you, Edward. I love your art. Immediately when I first saw the images that you were producing, I absolutely fell in love. And it was like very shortly after that I actually commissioned you to do
your logo, yeah.
My logo for my podcast.
She had a very specific idea of what she wanted, and luckily, you have a very easy face to make into a cartoon. So she wanted to be, I guess, Skull, and her face is a cartoon with a glove on.
Yeah, and my embalming tools.
Yeah, and some tools in your hands. So that was really fun to make.
And it was a unique conversation that we had, right? You're kind of like, what?
Yeah, I didn't know what her job was. The only thing I know is, this is probably going to butcher this, is it Morticia? Is she from like the Addams family or something?
Yeah, and so is that your impression of like death and women as far as they relate to death? That's
No, not really. I mean, there's a comic book like Lady Death. I don't know if you've heard of her.
I haven't.
Yeah, she's, there's her, and then I think I saw, there's a movie, where is it? Men in Black.
Yeah.
You see Men in Black, where the girl was in the I don't even know if it was a coroner's office or a coroner. Yeah, so I that was one of my impressions of it. So when you said embalmer, funeral home, I looked at your photos and stuff, and I was just like, no idea what that is. It's kind of taboo, so I don't know. I still don't really know. I mean, you told me a little bit today what it is, but it's very cloak and dagger.
It is. And that's part of the reason why I invited you here on the red sofa, because our industry touches people's lives every day, but a lot of times people don't really know what it is that we do, and they don't know the intricacies of the underbelly of the funeral industry, embalmers, funeral directors, coroners, pathologists, like we were talking about earlier. Like, and you asked, like, what's the difference? Did you have any specific questions that you wanted to ask me about my job that maybe people that aren't involved in the funeral industry want to know?
Correct me if I'm wrong, you're going to correct me. More a mortician, coroner, and then what you do, those aren't in the same building, right?
Correct.
So coroner's like state business, right?
Right, yeah, you're right. Typically, some coroners are funeral directors and embalmers, though, in small towns.
Gotcha.
In small towns, sometimes you'll have that. But yes, you're absolutely right. They're all separate. A pathologist is someone who actually has a medical degree. And so those are typically the people that are offering the autopsy. And I think sometimes people get that confused as well with what an embalmer is. And so sometimes people think that I do autopsies, but it's quite the opposite of that.
You're more of the presentation to the family type of deal you're telling me about. Because I always see in movies, what does a coroner say about this body and stuff? And we can't say anything until the autopsy comes out. So I always assume that's state business.
Right.
And then I just didn't know. You don't really know. Because it's always usually a bad memory when you go to a funeral. So it's something you don't really remember.
You try not to, right? Yeah, you try to block it out. I agree 100%. I think there's a lot of people that agree with you. on that subject. And you said something to me earlier that really, really struck a chord with me. And you have a deeper understanding about death and a lot of people that I talk to and that have questions for me. But you mentioned that in order to really understand life, you have to have a really true understanding of death.
And
that's profound to me. I agree with that 100%.
Yeah, you know, when you're thinking of your life in everyday terms, it's really easy to get caught up in the mundane, the monotonous, and you can go on autopilot and become a drone, and it's really easy to go that route. But what you have to realize is, as morbid as it sounds, death is around the corner, and you don't know when it's
coming. For any of us.
Yeah, for any of us, no matter how healthy or unhealthy you are. I see healthy people die all the time in the line of sports I do.
Right.
And I see unhealthy people outliving them all the time. So you just never know when it's going to happen. And when you realize that death is there always, it's always a possibility for all of us. I mean, it ultimately is all of our destination at the end.
We're born to die.
Yeah. And that in itself is what scares people, and people think that's morbid. But that's actually a beautiful thing, because you know that your time here is precious, and you shouldn't ever go on autopilot. You shouldn't take people or things for granted or opportunities.
I agree.
And 100%. Yeah,
it's hard not to do that though, right? When we're living life day to day.
It's easy to go on autopilot, and I think mankind's predisposition to do that is because we have so many things coming at us all the time. And it's easier to shut your brain off. And that's robbing you of your life. It's kind of like people that live only for the weekends. You know, people do that. They only live for vacation time. They only live a certain time. And it's like, that's not what life is. You should be not looking for the big moments, but looking for every little second in your day.
And I see you doing that a lot. I mean, obviously, you know, I'm following you on social media, so I don't know what goes on in your, you know, whole life. But I see a lot of that imagery in what you post on your Instagram. And, you know, you do post a lot of really, really amazing artwork, but you also post a lot about your personal, like, hobbies and how, like, biking. Can you tell us a little bit about that? And, like, how does that help you with your artwork, too?
Well, biking's one of those things I've been doing since as long as I've been doing my artwork. And, you know, if someone goes on my Instagram right now and they look at it, they'll see that I'm into biking just as much as art. And biking is the same thing with, you know, death. Is I've broken a lot of bones. My whole body's covered in scars. My face, I went to the dermatologist, so you can't really see the scars on my face, but I looked at the Terminator and scars.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So, you know, the more you get hurt, the more you realize, because there's seasons in your life when you're biking and you won't get hurt at all, and you literally feel immortal. You're pushing your body to limits you've never been to, and then what happens is the more you push your limits, you find them. And once you find them, you usually either wake up in a helicopter or the hospital. And,
right, yeah, and you were talking about that. Because I had asked Edward if he really, I was like, you probably really don't think about death, you know, doing what you do. And then he said, actually, I do. Like, I think about it every time I get on my bike.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that's valid.
Yeah, well, you know, there's trails where you ride and you have to be dodging rocks and you're going down cliffs that are at, like, a, you know, 15% downgrade. And you have to realize, you know, I'm having fun and I'm doing this and I'm capable, but there's also the flip side is extreme pain, death. You know, do you want to die today? It's not the deal. Do I want to go to this trail? Do I want to break a bone or something? And I always live my life... I don't want to pull a Fast and Furious tagline, but I do live my life. Someone asked me one time, what if this was the last day of your life? What would you do? And I always tell people I wouldn't be riding my bike, and I wouldn't be drawing. I would be hanging out with my family. And it's profound because you look out every other day I act like I'm not going to die, and I'm riding my bike and I'm drawing.
Right.
So I found balance is what I'm saying is I don't spend as much time as I used to riding my bike or drawing. I do spend a lot of time.
That quality time with the people that you love.
And being present, it's hard.
You shared with me earlier an experience that most people only get to maybe experience once in their life. And you shared with me that you actually died.
Yeah, I was bike racing, and I think I was 14, and I
so
was...
your heart stopped. You
that's what they said. Yeah. So I
think
I think it was a helicopter ride. I was out for a week and a half. So I had a major concussion. I broke my nose, my jaw, my collarbone, and they thought I broke my neck because I was riding. And you know, again, typical cyclist, you get cocky, and I was cocky because I hadn't crashed in, I think it was a year, and you get to a point where you think you're untouchable, and I was going over a jump, and someone's back tire, front tire hit my back tire, and
it
just launched me off into orbit, and then I, you know, landed, I think it was like 15 feet in the air already, so it
launched. And you remember this? You remember this?
I remember this because it's on video.
Wow.
So, and, you know, you fall, and the next thing I remember was them saying, don't fall asleep, like, stay awake, stay awake.
Hopefully we can share some of those clips.
I have, I don't know if I can find that clip. I think my mom probably buried it. I saw it a few years ago, though.
Wow.
But I think it might be on my Facebook. But I have a lot of clips of me racing when I was younger. But,
so what do you remember about that experience? Did you have, like, a near-death experience? Did you just wake up in the hospital?
Yeah, I didn't have a near-death experience, I would say. I would say I felt extreme pain, and I remember them trying to give me painkillers in pill form, and I because I don't like shots.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, dude, you're already really messed up. You need to get in your bloodstream. It'll be immediate. And then I remember eating some pizza, and then I don't remember that those like 3-4 months. I do remember.
Of, like, recovery,
yeah,
you mean?
I don't really remember those because I didn't.
So you did have, like, brain trauma.
I did, yeah. I was out for a while. I don't remember that month at all.
Do you think that experience has helped to shape your perception of death and how you're not, you don't really seem, like, when we've talked, you don't seem to have that fear like other people do?
No, I don't have fear of dying. And like I said, dying is natural. Don't want to live forever, that's for sure.
Yeah.
I don't. But at the same time, I do want to experience things with my family and things like that. But you know what? My life's been very blessed, and I've been very grateful for everything in my life. And if I die on my way home tonight...
Well, I'm grateful that we met.
Yeah,
I'm grateful
here.
That, you
yeah.
know, you helped me with my business and here at Cold Hands Host Studio, because that was a big deal for me to find an artist, and I feel like you really captured the artwork that I wanted to portray, and I wanted to portray the life and the death in one image and how I'm kind of relating to it, and I think you nailed it.
Thank you.
So
yeah.
I want to thank you for that. I've never been able to really thank you formally, but thank you for doing that. And then also, for all the people that want to see your artwork and see, you do live.
Yeah, I do live videos. You go to my Instagram, so you can put it in the video.
Can you let everybody know like
yeah.
where to find your
www.artofedwarddeniz.com or Eduardo Deniz, Z, at Instagram.
It's amazing. You guys have to check it out. Thank you for coming
yes.
and being here on the red sofa and taking time out of your day and sharing
me.
Your talents with us, Edward.
Thank you.